people often come up to me and they say things like, "Hey, Alan, you know how you're a scientist and a total poindexter? I've always wanted to know, what's the difference between a nerd and a geek?" For some people, there's a huge difference, but I really can't see one. To me, both are just words that describe super passionate people. So it doesn't matter if you're into athletics or anime, pruning or meals and booning, the kangaroos or mamaru, I think people that are unabashedly enthusiastic about the world are some of the best people I know. And I reckon that some of the most passionate people out there are scientists. One scientist, and surprisingly talented banjo player, changed the world by studying what she was most passionate about, and you know, won a Nobel Prize along the way. Her name was Barbara McClintock, and she revolutionized the way that we think about genetics. By studying the chromosomes of corn plants, Barbara ended up discovering both telomeres and centromeres, which have gone on to be super important in the field of biology. She also discovered transposons. Transposons are fascinating, but it's a rabbit hole so deep and so interesting that I'll never finish this video if I start talking about them now. When asked about her work, she gave a great bunch of quotes like,
"I had the joy of going at it. I was just so interested in what I was doing, I could hardly wait to get up in the morning and get at it. I never thought of stopping, and I just hated sleeping. I can't imagine having a better life."
Isn't it amazing that we learned so much about the world because someone was excited about corn? Me, I'm passionate about a bunch of stuff, but two things I love are genetics and dumb jokes. I love puns and dumb jokes so much that I'm worried that someone from the government is going to show up one day and insist that I run a household. "Well, I didn't realize Albert Einstein was an actual guy. Always assumed he was a theoretical physicist." So, as much as I love genetics and dumb jokes, they should absolutely never mix. And we know this because of Sonic Hedgehog. Okay, so back in the 1970s, it was this group of scientists that were trying to figure out how one cell turns into a complex body made up of millions and billions and trillions of cells. And to do this, they were studying flies. So just on a quick aside, you might be asking, why flies? Well, it's very simple. No one cares about flies.
"Oh, I thought we were friends."
And because no one cares about flies, these scientists were able to experiment on them. Through this experimentation, they found a bunch of different fly larvae that developed differently. By studying these special larvae, the scientists were able to discover the specific genes responsible for controlling how the different segments of the fly were formed. One of these genes kind of made the larvae look a little bit like a hedgehog if it wasn't working properly. So, in a stroke of creative genius, they decided to call that gene hedgehog. And when I say kinda, I mean kinda. Like, it didn't turn the flies into hedgehogs, it made the larva kinda look like hedgehogs, the same way a Buffalo Bill kinda looks like a cowboy, and kinda tastes like an ice cream. Now, because humans and flies share a common ancestor, our DNA is kinda similar. So some other scientists thought, "Hey, hedgehog is pretty cool. I wonder if people have a gene like hedgehog." It turns out that we do have a gene that's pretty similar to hedgehog. And because it was in the 1990s, the scientists decided to call the human version of hedgehog the most radical thing they could think of. They called it Sonic Hedgehog. It turns out that Sonic Hedgehog is really important in people. And when it's not working properly, it can make things really hard. I think it would be really difficult for patients and their families to learn that all their issues are the result of something called Sonic Hedgehog. Maybe giving a gene with an important role a very silly name wasn't a very good idea. While some areas of biology are quite serious, other areas allow scientists to have a little bit more fun and make references and jokes. We named a species of snail after Steve Irwin and a mushroom after SpongeBob. There was also a species of horsefly named after Beyonce. And I guess if you squint hard enough and use your imagination, it kind of looks like a queen bee. I think it's kind of cool that the scientists that make these discoveries are able to reference the other things that they're passionate about. And I know that these sorts of links help some people connect with complex topics. But when it comes to genetics, we need to be a little bit more restrained. Because when important genes play up, there can be serious consequences. And I'd be willing to bet that the novelty of these silly names wears off pretty quickly in a doctor's office. Saying that, it doesn't mean that we can't be excited about molecular biology or developmental biology or biochemistry. I just think that we nerds and geeks and other super passionate people need to come together and show our enthusiasm in other ways.